you know, in the last 18 years of your tenure with the bank and still going strong. We're all proud of the growth of the bank. So next, let's move on, Dr. Seetharaman. We'll get into the hot topic, COVID-19, human pandemic, which has really pressed the pause button on the lives of people around the world. Every economy, whether superpowers or emerging ones, are reeling under severe restriction already. Many economists, including yourself, have commented that this is by far the biggest economic challenge faced by the world after the Great Depression of 1930s. Globalization is turning into anti-globalization as countries are shutting down their borders in every continent and are busy dealing with the problems in-house. I personally believe the banks, and if I, it's a fact, the banks have an important role to play working with the government in tandem in every country and also with the regulators to bring the world back into its wheels post-COVID-19. What is your take on this? Do you believe that enough is done by the banks and governments in different countries? And what else is required beyond what you are seeing right now?
Let's understand that this is a great recession, as the economists or global pundits call it. It is an extraordinary set of transformation that nobody has seen after 1930 depression. What we have gone through in 2008 and 9 is confined to a financial crisis, the liquidity crisis on account of subprime mortgage, moved into a funding crisis, funding moved into a solvency and sovereign issue. Financial economies are truly converting us, trying to convert us real. Real economies are redefining the scope and performance. Communism has changed, capitalism is altering its form and substance, G7 has become G8, and G8 becomes G20, light switch regulation has failed. And quantitative easing, what you call printing money, improving the money supply, increasing the liquidity, inflating the depressed market, ensuring not only housing market, the hard money was transcending the entire financial market, including stocks, currencies, commodities, bonds, and the world at large was recovering. Today, what we are going through is beyond the financial crisis. It is economic sustenance, human sustenance, social sustenance, and again, enrollment sustenance. So all these pillars are getting redefined. You know, interpreting this kind of change and transition, what comes to my mind is a Oriental saying. The biggest discovery of this century is human beings have got capacity to alter their attitude of mind so that they can redefine their destiny. And that's what comes to my mind. The kind of transformation that we have seen in the last 4 months on the personal life as well as professional life has been prolific. Now, we have seen the initial descriptions in January when the IMF was predicting 3%. Originally, it was indicated as 3.7% when we met in Washington last year. And again, in April, they came with almost 3.7% contraction. I don't know, we have seen the television today, it says 4.9% is a contraction. Meanwhile, you know, World Bank said already 5.2%, OECD is talking about 6.7% if there's only no relapse or the second wave. If there is a second lapse, again, you will have, you know, the world will be taking extraordinary turn of events to recover in the next 4 years. That's the kind of transition we are going through. This is truly a pandemic, and the impact is going to be medium or long term, and it has created an enormous amount of damage. We are talking about 10 million people getting infected, and nearly 500,000 people are dead. 160 countries are totally under the belt. So it's extraordinary, the consequential impact we need to recognize. But at the same time, I have a very differentiated view, which I shared in a few forums. I see it as an opportunity in multiple form and substance. You know, Mother Nature has been crushed for a very long time. So sustainability should